if you want to soar like the eagle. Amen. Well, as I mentioned a few moments ago, it's just such a joy to have Ray and Janet Clark back with us again from Third Day Power. I know that you'll be encouraged and just strengthened by their ministry as to what they have to share today. Shall we welcome them at Faith Gospel? God richly bless you both. Thank you so much for being with us. Amen. I didn't do it, honest. Oh, praise the Lord.
Good morning. God bless you. I know you're excited to be in the house of the Lord. I heard you say you were earlier, so I won't ask you again. But we're excited to be back. Thank you to Pastor John. Is it okay if we move the pulpit back a little bit? Awesome. Get you involved in the team here. This way, we don't ruin the pulpit. It's okay? We can build another one, right? Tear it down and build it up again. We want to say thank you to Pastor John and Miss Christine for having us. You know, I just wondered, do you guys sleep with a smile on your face? I mean, they always have a smile on their face. I mean, it's probably, there could be the biggest storm in their life, and you probably never know it because they're always smiling. Yeah, I have to practice smiling. and sometimes I think you should look in the mirror and practice smiling yourself. I'm looking at your faces right now. You need to practice smiling. You should take that lesson from your pastors. Amen? sometimes we're so caught up in our thought life that we forget about that we're in the real world and we're living in here instead of out here. And so we pass up opportunities because we're so busy thinking about the things that we're going through or that we need to do or we should have done or they should have done or they could have done. Amen? Or oh me. Well, Ray was here back in April at the Elevate Men's Conference. And I know that they had a great conference. How many of the men were here for the Elevate Men's Conference? Can I see your hands? So, Pastor John, do you see all the other hands that are not up? They're going to register for the next one. And we were here on that Sunday evening. How many of you were here that Sunday evening when Ray and I were here ministering back in April? Can I see your hands? Awesome. Well, we're glad that you're back here this morning. We are privileged to travel around the world doing feats of strength. We can't sing. Can't dance like that young lady did. That was amazing. I got my video recorder out, and I was video recording her. Hope you don't mind if I put it on social media. I'm the social media queen. We're using our gifts and talents. Just as Pastor John said, you know, we have gifts and talents, and those gifts and talents aren't just for ourselves. They're to use to bring glory and honor to the Lord. And so I thank God that he can use our gifts and talents because God sure knew that I would not do well in a dress. Yeah. I told Christine, Pastor Christine this morning that she looked good in her dress. I said, I have a one similar to it. It's like a skirt. I said, the only thing is when I wear mine, I wear shorts underneath so it doesn't feel like I'm actually wearing a dress. And but God uses our gifts and talents, and he knew that for me, this girl here, that I loved workout clothes and tennis shoes, and that's what he uses. He uses what you have. He doesn't use something you don't have because you don't have it. So he uses what you have. If you do what you can with what you have, God will increase what you have, and he will not leave you where you are. I mean, just look at the woman real quick. This is free. The woman with the alabaster box, when she broke that jar open and she poured it on Jesus' feet, people said to her, why are you wasting your time and your money on him? You could have done something else with this money. You could have done something else. And Jesus said, leave her alone. You know, Jesus will stick up for you when you use your best for him. He said, hey, leave her alone. She did what she could. What are you doing with what you have? She did what she could for the gospel. And he said, I tell you the truth, that wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, her story is going to be told as a memorial unto her. Hello, somebody. He said, not unto me, but unto her. I'm going to use her story around the world because she did what she could. You say, well, I don't really have that much. I can't do much. Yes, you can. If you know how to serve, you got a gift. You know how to pour a cup of coffee? You got a gift. You know how to bake those banana things? You got a gift. Me, I know how to break stuff. That's a gift. My husband, well, he's got more than breaking stuff. He's a natural pro bodybuilder. That's right, natural pro, lifetime drug-free. He was Mr. Universe 2014, 2015. And I always like to tell people, because he's Mr. Universe, that makes me, you know, Mrs. Universe. Thank you. You can call me Mrs. Universe. And Ray has a show next week coming up in Washington, D.C., so we're excited about that. He's using his gifts and talents to serve the Lord. And whatever it is, whatever arena you're in, you're the light shining in darkness. And so we travel around the world doing feats of strength, breaking things and ripping things, as you're going to see this morning and tonight. We have a few things we're going to do this morning that Ray's going to share with you. And before he does that, I just want to share with you some of our product. We sold out last time we were here, and I trust that those of you that purchased the CDs are enjoying. How many of you are enjoying the CDs, the praise and worship CDs that you got when we were here last time? Can I see your hands? We sold almost all of, well, we actually sold all of them. And we brought some more back with us. This is Send Your Rain. And this one is We Are the Light. These were recorded live in South Africa, our home church in South Africa that we're a part of. We do all of our original music. It's not CDs, I say, that you buy from a missionary and you just throw them on the shelf to support them. You will love these CDs. They are incredible. And I say that to be there when they recorded it live was so phenomenal for the second one. The first one, when they were singing the songs during the praise and worship, I leaned over to one of the pastors and said, man, these songs are incredible. I was just crying. They were so powerful. And I'm like, who wrote these songs? And like, these are from our church. I'm like, they're from our church? They're like, yeah. And I was like, wow, amazing. Just anointed and powerful. And so we have our two CDs. And then last time we didn't have our testimony CDs. We have our testimony together on one CD. The Bible says in Revelations 12:11 that we're overcomers by what? The blood of the Lamb and the word of somebody else's testimony. No? Whose testimony? Your testimony, right? And so because of the blood of the Lamb, we have a testimony. I was raised as a Muslim. I had no clue about the blood of Jesus. I mean, that would have sounded really crazy. That was really crazy to me if you talked about the blood of Jesus to a Muslim. Like, what are you talking about? But a woman in a laundromat witnessed to me. She looked past my faults and saw my need of a Savior. She told me about God's love. And because of her, I'm here today. I should have been dead. I was strung out on cocaine. I tried to commit suicide twice. I was a high school dropout searching for love. But I thank God that that lady looked past my faults and saw my need. And so just that's a snippet of my testimony, Ray's testimony, and how we met in South Africa 18 years ago and got married 14 days after we met. And we're still together 18 years in a row. And then we have two preaching CDs. These are one of each of our favorites. One is The Blood That Speaks that Ray preached, and mine is Keep On Digging. It was about Isaac when his wells kept getting stopped up by his own enemies. What did he do? He didn't quit. He didn't give up. He just kept digging another well. And God not only gave him his old wells back, but he gave him new wells as well. And he reaped 100-fold in that same year in the most worst time of famine and drought. When you obey God, God will bless you. Amen? And then a couple other things. This is like a big package deal you're getting for 45 Canadian, not U.S. Canadian dollars. Our Jesus witness wear. This I've been wearing this for about 4.5 years. And people ask me about them all the time. So now we've actually been selling them. It's a Jesus fish wooden cross, wooden fish wear. And then also our Power to Be 3D bracelets. If you wear these, your bench will go up 10 pounds, guys. But those just help us with some of our travel schools. We speak in, when we were in South Africa, we spoke in 75 schools. In America, the schools that we speak in that can't have us in to speak in their schools, we use the product money that we are able to bring in to help pay for the schools that can't afford to have us. And when we go in, we talk about, the power of your choices, that you're not born a winner or a loser, you're born a chooser. That God has given you the power of choice. We talk about a dream maker and suicide, how suicide is a permanent decision to temporary problems. About bullying, I was a bully, so I can talk from a bully perspective on why I was a bully, because bullying is a big issue in schools today. Suicide is a big issue in schools today. One of the young men at our campus in Dulles, Virginia, her 16-year-old son just committed suicide 4 weeks ago without hope. He was a football player. He was an incredible young man, good-looking, had everything going for him. But why? Why do people give up? Because they have no hope. And it's our responsibility to share that with them. So that's what we do when we go into the schools, is we give them hope. And so with that, that's what these products help us do. So we just say thank you in advance for helping us.
Amen. Testing. Amen. How's everybody doing this morning? Come on now. Somebody say hallelujah. Let me know you're live. Somebody say hallelujah. Come on. This is the church of the living God. Come on. I need to see some smiles up in here. Come on. Don't just sit there and look at me like you've been sucking on lemons. Come on. Come on, this is a life birthing center. Come on. This is where destinies get birthed. Come on, somebody. Come on. You don't just come here for a religious experience. We come here for a relational experience. Come on. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Woo, hallelujah. I feel the presence. I feel the presence of the Holy Spirit in here this morning. You guys feel his presence this morning? How many of you know when the Holy Spirit shows up, he don't come empty-handed? Come on, somebody. He comes ready to distribute. Come on, somebody. I believe somebody in this morning, you're going to receive something this morning. I believe this morning you're going to receive something. The Holy Spirit is here. And when he comes with gifts in hand. Come on, somebody. How many of you been praying and believing God? How many of you been praying and believing God for a husband, for a spouse? Come on. How many of you been praying and believing God for your child to get back on the right track? Come on, somebody. Come on. There's a word in the house this morning. I said there is a word in the house this morning. You came at the right time. I know you went through hell to get here. Come on. You had a knockdown, drag-out fight with your wife. Your husband had a knockdown, drag-out fight with your wife, and your wife was fighting against the husband. You came to church and walked through to put that smile on. You know what I'm saying? Come on. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Y'all married couples, you know what I'm talking about. You had that knockdown, drag-out fight. Come on, in the car. But all of a sudden, you put the doors in the church, and hey, how you doing? Blessed. Hallelujah. God's been good to me. Come on. Come on. God looks past all that stuff. You know he does. You know he looks. He knows we're imperfect people. Come on now. We serve a good God. We serve a great big God. How much faith does it take to believe in a God who cannot fail us? I said, how much faith does it take to believe in a God who cannot fail us? So put a smile on your face. Come on. Because the reason why you're not carrying that smile, because you think you're going under. You're not going under. You think you're going under. Come on. You're not going under. You're going over. Come on, somebody. You're not going under, you're going over. Come on. You have a covenant partner. Come on now. You have a covenant relationship. Come on. Through the blood of Jesus. Come on now. Come on. Well, you know that God is on your side. Woo! Come on. That alone can put a smile on your face. When you know that God is on your side. When you know that God is on your side, that simply means this. Nothing shall be denied when God is on your side through the blood. When God is on your side, nothing, absolutely nothing will be denied when God is on your side. When you know that God is on your side, every need shall be supplied. Come on. When you know that God is on your side, come on, you will pass this test. When you know that you know that you know that you know that your knower knows that God is on your side, you will pass the test and you will receive God's absolute best. When you know that God is on your side. I'm pumping somebody up this morning. Come on. Come on. Come on, I'm giving you mouth-to-mouth resuscitation this morning. I seen you sitting there with that look on your face. Come on. You got to remember how big your God is. Come on. He's the one who flung the stars into space. Come on, may I remind you who he is? Come on. That thing you're facing, that's not impossible. It's impossible with you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. In your own limited abilities, human capacities, yeah, for you, it is impossible. You're right. For you, but not with God. Come on, somebody. Come on. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We have an awesome, we have a word we want to deliver this morning, but also, of course, we break things, we bend things, we rip things, so that's what we're going to get into this morning. But I want to remind you again, as Pastor John said, my wife said, this evening, we will be back breaking things this evening, exploding things this evening. And our prayer and our desire is that you become an evangelist, all right, between now and then. Get on the phone when you leave here. Get on the phone. Start texting some friends. Start texting some of those unsaved friends you like to hang out with every once in a while and say, hey, we got this crazy couple at our church. They're going to be bending things and breaking things. The guy, he's a Mr. Universe. He was a Mr. Universe. The woman is one of the world's strongest women. And I just want to come and pick you up and bring you to our, that's called evangelism. Come on, somebody. I just want to come to your house. Don't even worry about driving. I'm going to come and pick you up at so-and-so time. We're going to get there early because it's going to be packed out. Come on, you got to speak evangelistically. Come on. So you want to get there early, so I'm going to come and pick you up early. Maybe we'll take them out to eat somewhere. Come on, somebody. I'm going to take you out. We're going to go. We're going to have a good time. Watch these crazy Christian strong couple break stuff and rip stuff. So you do the best you can, and God will bless your socks off. I say he will bless your socks off. Right now, we have some things we want to do. And some of the things you've seen have been featured on our World Strong Man competition on ESPN, the sports network. And here's something my wife, she's actually one of the only few women in the world who can actually do this. She is going to take this phone in just a few seconds, and she is going to tear it right down the middle as if it's one sheet of paper. How many of you want to see that this morning? Come on, open up your mouths, make some noise. Let's go.
You know, as I take this phone book and rip it in half right now, I want it to represent the choices that we make. We all make choices each and every day, whether they're right or wrong, good or bad, up or down. And a lot of times we let our choices that are not so good hinder us from moving forward, or things that people have done to us, we keep it in this book, and every time we see them, we're reminded of what they did to us. And so we can't seem to move forward. But I'm so grateful that I was taught how to forgive and to let go of my past, because I had a lot of anger and rage and bitterness on the inside of me because of things that happened to me as a child growing up and as an adult, things that were unfair purposely and unintentionally. But I had to choose to let go. I had to choose to forgive. You know, Jesus said, if you forgive, I forgive. He said, if you don't forgive, I won't forgive you, because we tie his hands when we don't forgive. We want to receive something. We want to be free from our mess, but we don't want to release somebody else from what they did to us. And so when you learn the power of forgiveness, you learn the power of God's true love, because God's love never puts us down. He never reminds us of our past to condemn us or to hurt us. He always pushes us to our future. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. Amen. Thank God that when we were unfaithful in the garden, you think about Adam and Eve, they were unfaithful. I mean, the very first two human beings didn't even get it right. God made everything in the world for us, but he made us for him. We're the only creation in the image of God made in his image. He didn't make a bird like him, a tree like him, a monkey like him. He made us like him. And everything in this world is for us. But he said, there's one thing, just one thing. It's for me, not for you to touch. And that one thing wasn't even it wasn't even about the tree. It was about the choice. Would you obey me? Jesus said, if you love me, you'll obey me. And if that tree weren't there, if that tree, which represented the power of choice, we would have never known what love is, because love is a choice. God chose to love us when he made us. His love, he chose to unconditionally love us. If that tree that Adam and Eve were told not to take from, if that tree were never there, we wouldn't even know what it would be like to be a free will person, to make choices. So he didn't put two trees and say, don't touch from those two trees. He made it simple, just one, obey me. That's it. And in that garden, when they were unfaithful and disobedient and they betrayed God's word, you think about Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus, he could have said, God, I ain't doing this. No, not for them. They're going to do this, then. Nope. But he kept saying, Father, can you take this cup from me? But nevertheless, not my will, your will be done. The Bible says he prayed so hard and he was in such anguish that he began to bleed great drops of blood. Now, that was the first place Jesus shed his blood, was in the garden. That blood represents faithfulness, faithful unto the death. He bled to cover our unfaithfulness so that we can learn how to be faithful. And so when you recognize the power of faithfulness and forgiveness, you won't let anything stop you from moving forward. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. Amen. Let your past be gone today. Let those that have hurt you be free today. Walk in forgiveness. Walk in the love of God. Let it go.
Amen. Let it go. Hallelujah. By the blood of Jesus, let it go. Come on. All right. Get behind her. Encourage her. Help her out. Taking this phone book, tearing it right down the middle. Here she goes. Woo. Come on. Put those hands together. Make some noise. Come on. Woo. Let's go. Come on. Oh, my goodness. Come on. Come on. Help her. Help her. Woo. Let's go. Come on. Oh, my goodness. Come on, Miss Janet. You got this. Come on, honey. You got this. Come on. Woo. Let's go. Let's go. Come on. Come on. You got this. Come on. Come on.
Because my heart is breaking. Tell it. Are you left? Are you right? Taking sides. When are we gonna realize we all bleed the same? We're all beautiful when we come together.
Come on, help her, help her, help her, help her.
We all bleed the same.
Come on, you can do it.
So tell me why we're
all right. Yes. 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 Hallelujah. All right. Awesome. I'm glad I'm married to one of the world's strongest women. I'm glad I'm married. Not only do I have the Holy Ghost on my side, but I got one of the world's strongest women on my side. So you don't want to mess with us. Come on now. But most importantly, I got the blood on my side. Come on. I got the blood of Jesus. Come on, somebody. I got the blood of Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I love that scripture my wife shared a few moments in Revelation chapter 12. And says that we overcome. Come on, somebody. We overcome by the what?
Overcome.
We overcome by the what? We overcome by the what? You overcome by the what? Come on, you overcome by what? The precious blood of the Lamb. Don't you ever, ever forget that. Don't you ever forget how powerful the blood of Jesus is. Without the blood, we wouldn't be sitting here today. Come on. Without the blood. But thank God for the blood. Thank God for the blood. You know, growing up, I want to share quickly my testimony. I want to share a word out of the Word of God that God put on my heart this morning as I was up on the treadmill while y'all was asleep. I was up doing on the treadmill, working it out. You know what I'm saying? And while I was on that treadmill, just the Holy Spirit began to download. How many of you know? Sometimes the Holy Spirit just begin to download things in your spirit just instantly, like an instant download. I love those moments. Don't you love those moments, Pastor John? He just began to download in your spirit. You're like, oh, my goodness, my God. And so I'm going to share that with you coming up. But speaking on the blood, which is what we do, because the blood is what saved us. The blood is what delivered us. The blood of Jesus is what keeps us. And growing up, the blood has restored my mind. You see, the blood has supernatural powers and capabilities. It changes you at the DNA level. It changes the mitochondria within your cells. That's for my doctors and medical people. But that's what the blood of Jesus does. It begins to change you at the cellular level. It begins to regenerate you from the inside out, the power of the blood. It will take a messed up, crippled mind and begin to restore that mind. That's the power of the blood of Jesus. And so growing up, I was taken away from a biological mom and stepdad because of the abuse that I experienced and placed inside of a foster care home. I was raised temporarily by foster parents, and I'm not here to put down or bash foster parents. I didn't have a good experience with foster parents because even in that foster care home facility I was in, I went through horrendous abuses. And fortunately. I have a grandmother. I had a grandmother who has since passed away. She passed away in 2008. But when I was 7, 8 years old in that foster care facility, hadn't seen my biological mom in quite a while. My grandmother, she would come and she would visit me. Thank God for grandparents. Come on. A lot of y'all wouldn't be sitting in church had it not been for your grandmother. Come on. I said a lot of y'all wouldn't be sitting here had it not been for your grandmother. Come on. Had it not been for your granddad. Come on. Had it not been for that auntie. Come on. Praying aunties, grandmas, and granddads. Where would we be without them? And so my girl, she would come and visit us. And one of the last times she came to visit us, she told me, my younger brother, his name's Andre. Call him Dre. She came she came with papers in hand, and she said, I'm going to adopt you boys. We were actually in a foster care system in Buffalo, New York. And she came to Buffalo, New York from Florida, and she said, I'm going to adopt you boys, and I'm going to take you back to Florida. And that's what she did. Now, when she brought us into her home, and the home that I grew up in, my grandmother's home, today, you know, it's very, it's very politically correct. You know, to have it's a democracy. Well, in my home, there was no democracy. It was a dictatorship. She dictated what you did, when you did it, and how you did it. And if you didn't do it right, she would bring some correction. Come on, somebody. Do y'all know what switches are? Switches? Oh, y'all. Come on, some of y'all know the older folk know what a switch is. Come on. They touch you, the anointing will touch you when that switch touches you. You'll start jumping around and dancing. Hallelujah. But she believed in strict discipline. She taught me, she trained me. The Bible says that if we are to train up a child in the way they should go, when they got old, they should not depart. So that's what she did. She trained us, she disciplined us, she brought correction when we needed it. But most importantly, at night, before we go to sleep, we'd kneel down with her at our bedside. I would be on one side. My brother Dre, he would be on the other side. And she would get on her knees. We'd get on our knees. And we begin to call on the name of Jesus. You know, she spent so much time in church, which meant that we spent a lot of time in church. I spent a lot of time in church, like some of y'all did. Come on. Come on. Y'all still getting counseling, right? Yeah, I'm still going through counseling for that. And I say that because our services, you know, our services didn't get out at like 12. Y'all got it made today. See, y'all got it made. Plus, you got these comfortable pews. Well, the church I grew up in, we had old wooden benches, Pastor John. and they had little cracks in them. And if you slid the wrong way, those little cracks would pinch your little honey. And some of the mothers, you know, they had the little pads underneath the seat. And one thing you would never do was sit in mother's chair, because she would lay some gangster hands on you sitting in her spot. Certain place you just didn't sit. Everybody, no, that's mother, that's mother's. You don't want to sit there. And so I grew up, you know, going to church and being made to go to church. My grandmother, she was a disciple. She was a follower of Christ. She exemplified the love of God, the love of Christ. And I seen the way she loved people. And so I spent all that time in church. But how many of you know, just because you spend time in church does not mean you're born again? As the Bible says in John 3:3, just because you go to church does not mean you're saved. Come on, somebody. Just because you go to church does not mean you have a relationship with Jesus. Come on, you can come to church and have a religious experience, but don't really know about a relational experience. Come on. Jesus wants a relationship with us. He doesn't want your religious. He doesn't want your religious deeds and religious duties you perform. He's not interested in that. He's interested in a living, breathing relationship. I didn't know that growing up. And so all of a sudden, I become a young man. I got off on my own. I was in the military. And what you have to understand and know is this, is that inside of each and every one of us, with every person within the sound of my voice, you see, there is a God-shaped void on the inside of us, a God-shaped void. And without a relationship with Jesus Christ, we will try to fill that void with some of the most craziest things in life. We'll try to fill it with success. We'll try to fill it with degrees. We'll become a master at something. We'll earn a PhD. We'll earn all these titles and initials. But none of those things will fill the void. And then all of a sudden, once we start earning all the PhDs and all that, I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with that stuff. That's great. That's awesome. To be successful, that's awesome. That's great in this world. But you know, at the same time, we cannot allow that to become our God. It cannot be the foundation of who we are. Those things cannot fill the void. And so I tried filling the void with alcohol, with women, with drugs. And I got to a place in my life where I was sick and tired of being sick and tired. Have you ever been there before? Some of you in that place right now. Come on. Some of you are sick and tired of being in your marriage. You thinking the grass is greener on the other side. Well, if I just had another wife, if I just had another husband. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on, I'm talking to you this morning. Come on, the grass is not greener on the other side. It's just artificial turf. That's all it is. Come on. And so here I was, a young man, desperate for change in my heart and my life. I was 22 years of age. I turned the television on one day. I was in my apartment, turned the television on. I turned to the local religious station. And my grandmother, listen to this. And I'm going to take this bat and break it. Listen to this. My grandmother, actually, when I was 10 years old, my great-great-grandmother was still living. And so my great-great-great-grandmother, my great-great-great-grandmother, and my great-grandmother, they would watch TBN, Trinity Broadcasting Network, all day long. All right? I'd come home from school, and TBN be playing. So I grew a dislike for religious programming because that's all I played in my house. That's all that was on my. I would be walking home. I would be walking home from school, and I'd hear. I can still hear their voices. I'd be walking on the sidewalk, and I would hear these preachers preaching. And I'd walk in the house, and I'd be like, "Can y'all like watch something else? Come on, there's many other things we can watch on television besides Christian TV." So anyway, I began to develop a strong dislike for Christian programming. But here I was at the age of 22. And my life was going nowhere fast. And I knew that. I understood that. And I turned to Christian television. There's a man on there preaching. I didn't know who he was. Some of y'all might know who he is today. His first two initials is TD. I'll leave it at that. And so I didn't know who he was back then. He began to preach on the purpose and plan of God and the love of God. Right there, I did something I never thought I'd do. I got there on my knee in front of my television set, and I asked Jesus Christ to come into my heart, to change me, to rearrange me. But most importantly, I repented of my sin. I repented of my wrong attitude, wrongful behavior. Notice, check this. I didn't say I was sorry. I repented. See, many people, Pastor John, they will say, I'm sorry, but there is no act of repentance, which means there is no change of mind, which means there is no change of heart, which means there is no change of direction in their life. And they'll just keep saying, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. No, no, no. God's not looking for your apology. He's looking for your repentance. Repentance means to be going in one direction, stop what you're doing, and go in the other direction. That's what God is looking for, just to let you know. And so I repented of my sin that day, and when I did that, I had an encounter with Jesus Christ in my living room. I had an encounter with him. I felt as if for the first time, a dark cloud that had been over my life, I felt for the first time that dark cloud was gone. I felt for the first time in my life, there was freedom. We were singing Amazing Grace earlier. That day I experienced and touched and felt amazing grace. I was liberated from hatred, from anger, from unforgiveness, from bitterness, from rage. I was liberated. I was a free man. I felt so light on my feet. And all of a sudden I had a desire. No one told me to, but I had a desire. I knew within my heart of hearts, because the Holy Spirit was on the inside of me, I knew in my heart of heart that I needed to go to church. I started going to church. Church had three services. Guess how many services I would sit through? You guessed it right. I would sit through all three services. I started reading my Bible. All of a sudden, I started reading the Word of God, meditating on the Word. My mind became renewed. I began to take on the mindset of a winner, of a champion, of an over. See, it's no accident that I wear in bodybuilding shows and I wear many different titles. Why? Because the Word has reconditioned my thinking. My brain has been washed and watered by the living Word of God. Come on, somebody. My life has never been the same. And what the blood of Jesus has done in my life, it continues to do. What God has done in my life, it continues to do. He can do the same for you. He is a God who can take the broken, shattered, fragmented pieces of your life and put it back together again. Let's give Jesus a big hand clap. Come on. As I take this bat and break it this morning.
Swinging for the fences.
All right.
It's like this heart is defenseless against a passion that's pumping through my veins. Blood, sweat, tears, it's a calling. And if I can't walk, then I'm crawling. It might flicker, but they can't kill the flame.
Woo! Ray has a nickname. It's actually called the Batman. I'm glad he did that pretty easy this morning. Sometimes he has a difficult time, and one time he actually asked me to help him. I'm like, are you serious? You want me to help you? I'm supposed to ask you to help me. But he broke it. I'm going to take this hot water bottle, and this is probably one of the hardest things that we do. And is to take this hot water bottle and literally blow it up until it explodes. It's not a balloon. It's a thick rubber hot water bottle. You put water in it when you have like cramps or muscle aches, and it helps, you know, soothe the pain. Well, I'm going to take this and actually blow it up until it explodes. And I just want to ask you a question today. I know we've been sharing our testimonies and encouraging you in the Word, but how many of you feel the pressure in your life right now? Nobody? Just me? Okay. My God, you got some great people in your church. They got some great faith. I see about five hands. Everybody else said, I'm good. I'm doing good. Oh, yeah, I'm good. No, you lying. You lying. You lying in church. Look, we're all going through something. You're either going in a storm, you're in a storm, or you're coming out of a storm. Jesus said, in this world, you're going to have tribulations, so be of good courage. Just be happy about it. And I'm like, are you sure you want me to be happy? Because I'm not feeling very happy right now, Lord. Matter of fact, I'm not happy, Lord. Why are you letting me go through this? I thought you said you love me. Well, if you love me, why would you let me go through this storm, huh? because I love you. If we never had a storm, we'd never have a test. If we never had a test, we'd really never know what we believed. See, the tests come to show you what you really believe. It's easy to preach on Sunday in the pulpit when you got, you know, 400 or 500 people watching you, but then when you got to walk it out by yourself, it's a different story. Amen? And so God has given us promises, and sometimes those promises, they take a little bit longer than we want to come. But we got to hold on when the storms come. When the storms come, it's really, what do you believe when the storms come? And so I'm going to wear some protective wear to protect my eyes. Sometimes when these blow up, they hit you really hard. But you got to hold on to the word of God. He who began a good work in you will be what? He'll think about completing it in you. No, he'll be faithful to complete it. The Bible says in Psalms 138, verse 8, he will perfect those things that concern you. He is a perfecting God. He's perfecting those things in you. And it's the pressures and the storms and the trials that mold our character, our integrity, our who we are on the inside, our faith. Our faith only comes when the challenges greet us. Faith doesn't grow without a test, and a test comes in the form of a storm or pressure or adversity. Faith grows in those. Our faith would never grow if there was never a storm. If there was never a challenge, our faith would never grow. If Ray or I didn't go to the gym and work out, we'd never become strong. We wouldn't be the strong people that we are if we didn't allow their resistance training to work for us. So it's the resistance that makes you stronger.
Amen. It is the resistance that makes us stronger. But thank God we got a trainer called the Holy Ghost. All right. All right. Get behind her. Encourage her. Help her out. Come on, Jen. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Come on. Woo! If God be for you, no one can be against you. Come on now. If God be for you, no one can be against you. Woo! Let's go. Let's go. Come on. Yeah, let's go. Come on. It takes about 2,000 pounds per square inch to blow up a hot water bottle. It is the hardest thing that we do. Woo! She's one of the only women in the world. She's one of the only women in the world who can actually blow up a hot water bottle. Takes tremendous lung power, abdominal strength, and endurance. Woo! Come on, let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Come on. Yeah, let's go. Watch this. Watch this. Woo! Come on, let's go. Woo, come on. It's wavy on me. It's wavy on me. It's wavy on me. Come on, help her, encourage her, help her. Come on. Open up your mouths, make some noise. Let's go, come on. Oh my goodness. Woo! Oh, my, my, my. Oh, oh. Oh, my goodness. Honey, you actually quit at the halfway mark. You're almost there. Oh, my goodness. That means you got to start all over. Oh, my God. My God. Praise the Lord. My God. It just in case you didn't know, it takes about 2,000 pounds per square inch to blow up a hot water bottle. So she's one of the only women in the world who can actually do this. But I'm gonna let her rest, and I just want to deliver you an email from heaven. Is that all right? I want to deliver y'all an email. I know that this word that I'm going to share this morning is for many of you sitting out there, and this word is going to usher you into a new season of your life. Because just like my wife, she quit and she gave up at the halfway mark, and I believe that there are some people sitting out here this morning. You don't know it, but God wants you to know you're at the halfway mark. Now is not the time to quit. I said, now is not the time to quit. Now is not the time to give up. You're at the halfway mark. Come on. All right, she just alerted me that she's going to try that again tonight. She would try it again tonight this evening. So make sure you come out just to see that, because the hot water bottle gets huge. You seen how big it was? It gets a lot bigger than that. But so this word is just an encouragement to you. I have a few more minutes, so I have to move along very hastily. But I want you to know this word is for you. You didn't come here this morning by accident or coincidence or incident. You came here on purpose. Not only is this word for you, but it's for your family. How many of you know God loves you with an everlasting love? It doesn't matter how far, listen to this. It doesn't matter how far you think you are away from God. He still loves you. He's never changed his mind about you. Come on. You're still the apple of his eye. You're still his treasure. Now, you might have stepped away and gotten involved with some things you shouldn't have been involved in. But you know what? His love for you is just as great today as it was in the past. Come on, somebody. God is love. He's not waiting to pounce on you. And some religious-minded people, they will say things like, well, God's going to get you. God don't like ugly. God's going to get you. No. That's not the God of the Bible. The Bible says God is love. Love always believes the best. That's what Paul said. Love believes the best. So even when you're at your worst, God sees the best in you. Come on, somebody. Who would not want to serve a God like that? Who would not want to serve a God such as that? Even when you're at your worst, His love for you is just as great. His love changed my heart. I told you what I went through. I went through a lot of traumatic events in my life. Molested at a young age. I went through a lot of traumatic things. Oh, but the love of the Father. Oh, but the love of God. His love can restore your mind. You don't need no medication. You need the living, breathing Word of God. Oftentimes, it is traumatic events that will destroy our minds. Oftentimes, people need medication just to get through the day. Oh, but when you have a relationship with Jesus, when you have a relationship with the living, breathing Word of God that is bathed in the precious blood of the Lamb, this Word, I tell you, it will transform your mind. It will bring healing, restoration, and deliverance to your life. Hallelujah. All right, this for the next few months, we're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 14. And chapter 14 and verse 13, and I'm going to be moving along. And so just to set this up, because of the sake of time, one of Jesus' good friends, John the Baptist, has just been beheaded, so he retreats back to a secluded place to be by himself, and but while he's there, the crowds begin to gather. And as the crowds begin to gather, of course, his disciples are with him. And the Bible says that he had compassion on them, on the crowd. And he began to have a revival. And He began to restore them and heal them and cure them of their diseases. Come on. God can heal you of your dis-ease. Some of you walked in a diseased state. You are diseased in your heart. You are diseased in your marriage, in your family. God wants to touch your life. So watch this. And so verse 15, when the evening came, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote and barren place, and the day is now over. Send the throngs away into the villages to buy food for themselves." But Jesus said, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." They said to him, their disciples speaking to Jesus, they said to him, "We have nothing. We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fishes. See, they were looking at their own human capabilities and capacities. They were placing limitations on themselves. How many of you know God does not want us placing limitations on ourselves? Watch this. Verse 8, he said, bring them here to me. Verse 9, he ordered the crowds to recline on the grass, and he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. Looking up to heaven, he gave thanks, blessed, and broke the loaves, and handed the pieces to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the people. So we see here how Jesus himself took what they thought was impossible and made it possible. And I want to share something with you this morning. If you'll take what's in your hand, what you're trying to hold on to, what you're trying to control, whether it's a marriage, whether it's a relationship, if you'll just release it and place it in the hands of Jesus, he will bless your situation. Come on. He'll bring some good out of your situation. Come on. If you'll do what you can in the natural, watch this. If you will do what you can in the natural, which is release what you have in your hands, God says, "I will do what you can't do. I will do the supernatural." He's a God of the supernatural. And they all ate and were satisfied. They picked up 12 small hand baskets full of broken pieces. Verse 21, and all those who ate were about 5,000 men and women, including women and children. And then verse 22. Verse 22. So here they're experiencing the divinity of Jesus Christ. They experienced this supernatural miracle right before their faces. They witnessed the power of Jesus. Come on, somebody. How often we have witnessed the faithfulness of God in the past. We have witnessed the supernatural ability of God to provide in the past. But all of a sudden we start going through situations and circumstances, and all of a sudden we forget what God has done in the past. Watch this. I'm speeding along. Here we go. Get ready. Put your seatbelts on. Now, then, verse 22, then he directed the disciples to get into the boat and go before him to the other side. Where were they going? The other side. That was half the room. Where were they going? The other side. Who gave them the word? Who told them to get into the boat? Who told them they were going to the other side? That's all I wanted to know. All right. All right. Verse 23. And after he had dismissed the multitudes, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Why did he go up there? Because he knew something they didn't know. So what did he do? He began to intercede for them. Come on, Jesus is praying for your situation. Come on. He knew something they didn't know. They were getting ready to hit something. They were beginning to hit some unfamiliar territory. And he seen it coming. So what did he do? He stood in the gap and he began to intercede for them because he knew what they were coming up against, they were not going to be any match for it. Come on. And because they were in relation, watch this, because they were in relationship with Jesus, come on, you better be in relationship with Jesus. Come on. Come on. The things you're facing, the things you're going to face, come on. You had better be in relationship with Jesus. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. He dismissed Moses one of the hills and himself to pray. When it was evening, he was still there alone. Verse 24, oh my goodness, it's getting scary. My God, it's getting scary. But the boat was by this time, this is the Amplified translation, sounds better to me. But the boat was by this time out in the sea, many furlongs, a furlong is 1/8 of a mile distant from the land, watch this, beaten and tossed by the waves. Isn't it something? God gives you a word. You're so excited. I got a word from God. God gave me a dream. God gave me a vision for this business, for this marriage, for this family. He gives you a word. God, you told me to move here to Canada. I know I heard from you, God. I thought maybe I missed God. Maybe do I have sin in my life? Why is this stuff happening to me? Do I have sin in my life? What is wrong? Why is my life? Why is all everything seems to be falling apart all around me? God, am I missing you? What is the problem? What is the deal? And so now here they are. Now when you study this out, that word there, that word beaten is actually the same word. That word means to be, it means to experience trauma mentally. So here they are in the middle of the sea. The waves are building up. The waves are overcoming the boat. The wind is blowing. The wind was contrary. And so the waves are crashing to the boat. Now they're in a mental condition. They're in a traumatic experience. They're in the storm of their lives. As a matter of fact, one translation says, the boat was literally at the point of breaking apart. I think I would be a little scared in that situation, too. I ain't going to lie. I'm not a spiritual giant. I'm telling you what, I don't even like being out in the ocean, to tell you the truth. Especially in the middle of the water, as they were in the middle of the water. And so the boat was at a point of breaking apart. They're in this state of being mentally tormented, this traumatic mental experience, emotional experience. It's pitch black, it's dark, wave after wave. Come on. How many of you ever been in a situation, some of you in a situation where wave after wave of things you didn't expect just keep hitting your life? And you thinking, God, where are you in this? What in the world? I haven't cussed in years, but I'm getting ready to cuss. Just being real, come on. So they were being beaten and tossed by the waves. The word says that the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch, between 3 and 6 of the night, that's the darkest hour of the night. This was a dark experience, y'all. Pitch black. The boat, you can hear the boat breaking apart. The waves are hitting you again and again and again. The wind is keeping you, holding you back to where you can't move forward. Come on. What do you do? Well, most of y'all would do what they did. Watch this. Jesus, my God, it's good to be in relationship with Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Jesus came to them walking on the sea, on the very thing that they were being perplexed and troubled by. Jesus was showing absolute supreme authority, saying, what you worried about this? You mean to tell me you just witnessed my supernatural power with the 5 loaves and the few fish, and you mean to tell me this is what you're worried about? Jesus is showing his absolute divinity by walking on the water. Watch this, it gets better. And so, verse 1, when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified. Grown men shouting like little girls. Come on, somebody. Can you imagine? It's pitch black. The waves are crashing over the boat. You're going to hear pieces of the boat breaking off, creaking and cracking, breaking off. I think I might be screaming too. I don't know. I got some muscles, but I don't know. I don't like being in the water like that. Come on. And so the boat is literally breaking apart, the waves, the wind. And so watch this, disciples. They see him walking there. They were terrified and said, it is a ghost. And they screamed out with fright. Woo! Ah! We going to die. We going to die here, y'all. Can y'all imagine Peter? Look, we going to die, y'all. We going to die. This is it for us. We done. We died. Because when they seen it, they thought Jesus was a ghost. Watch this. Verse 27. But instantly, he spoke to them, saying, take courage. Come on, somebody. In other words, he was saying, don't doubt. He said, don't doubt. And I'm going to show you in just a few moments what happens when you doubt. I'm going to show you in just a few moments what happens when you doubt. He was saying, take courage. Come on, somebody. I'm here to tell some of these men, take courage, sir. Come on. Put those shoulders back. Put that head up high. You take courage and be the man who God has called you to be. Come on. Take courage. He said, take courage. I am. Stop being afraid. I came to tell some ladies and stop being afraid. What are you fearful of? Fear is false evidence appearing real. I said, fear is false evidence appearing real. How much faith does it take to believe in a God who cannot fail you? What are you afraid of? Whew. Come on, Jesus is on your side. Watch this. Verse 28. I'm moving along. My time's coming to a close. 28. And Peter answered him, Lord, I love this. Even in his state, his traumatic state of being frightened and screaming like a little girl, he says, watch this. Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it is you, command me to come on the water. My. He was tapping into something right there. Come on. In other words, he was saying, Lord. Actually, one translation says this. It says, Lord, since it is you, give me a word. Peter was saying, Lord, since it's you, give me a word. See, when you're in the middle of your storm, all you need is one word from God. Come on, somebody. One word from God can take you to the other side of that storm. One word from God. One word from God. And so Peter, he says, Lord, bid me to come since it's you. Allow me to come. Peter steps out. See, sometimes in order to receive what God has for you, listen to me, young ladies, young men. In order to receive in this next season what God has for you, you can't be connected with the crowd. You have to be willing to follow the cloud. Come on, somebody. In order to receive what God has for you, you're going to have to let go of the crowd and start following the cloud. Come on. Woo! Peter stepped away out of the boat. He was stepping away from the crowd, stepping away from the naysayers. I'm sure they're screaming, Peter, you're going to die. Peter, you're going to drown. But Peter had a word from God, y'all. He had a word from God. And so Peter stepped out of the boat, and as he began to walk on the, because he walked on the water, y'all. It says in the text he walked on water. So as Peter began to walk on the water, he began to walk in the supernatural realm. Come on, somebody. You see, the word will usher you into the supernatural realm where all things are possible, where nothing is impossible. Yeah. Nothing is impossible. When you got the living, breathing word of God in your mouth, on your heart and in your mouth, Peter stepped out, began to walk on. He was walking on the word. He was walking on the word, full of faith, full of power. But all of a sudden, verse 29, of course, Jesus said, come. Peter got out of the boat, walked in the water, came towards Jesus. Watch this. Verse 30. You see, when you're in the storm of your life, you cannot be distracted. When you have a word from God, you cannot be distracted. What's going on your left? What's going on your right? You have to stay focused. You got to stay centered on the word. You can't allow the naysayers to try to hold you back and keep you back from where God is taking you. And when you take a step out, you got to know that as I step out of this boat, Jesus, I believe because you gave me a word. I believe that I'm going to reach my destination. Hallelujah. But Peter began to get distracted. When he began to take notice, he felt the resistance of the wind coming against him. He felt the splashing of the water hitting him in his face. And then all of a sudden, he took his eyes off Jesus. What happens when you take your eyes off Jesus and doubt begins to set in? Unbelief begins to set in. Watch this. But when Peter perceived and felt the strong wind, he was frightened yet again. And as he began to sink, He cried out. You see, when you have doubt in your heart when it comes to the promise of God, it'll take you to a place of depression. Come on. Sinking means depression. He was in a depressed state of mind, state of being. Why? Because he began to doubt the word. He ended up in a depressed state, mentally, physically, spiritually. Why? Because he doubted the living word of God. The word he was walking on, he began to doubt. Watch this. I love this. Verse 31. Instantly. See, that's the power of having a relationship with Jesus. That's the power of having a relationship with Jesus. Instantly, Jesus reached out his hand, caught and held him, saying to you, you O little faith, why did you doubt? You see, he didn't rebuke him because of his little underdeveloped faith. He rebuked him because of his doubt. You see, the doubt brought him to that sinking, depressed state. But watch this. Verse 32, and when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat knelt and worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Verse 34. I'll close right there. Verse 34. And when they had, what's that? When they had what? When they had what? When they had crossed over. You see, they reach their destination. I'm here to tell you this afternoon, you are going to reach your destination. Come on. You're going to reach your destination. Now is not the time to give up on the living word of God. Come on, don't grow weary in well-doing, for you shall reap a harvest if you faint not. That means this, if you choose not to throw in the towel and give up, the word of God says in Galatians, you will reap a harvest if you choose not to grow weary. Some of you have grown weary, but today is the day, God says, you're going to the other side. In spite of what you're going through, in spite of what you're in the middle of, in spite of what you're coming out of, God says, you're going to the other side. He has something bigger waiting on you. He sees your struggle. He sees your trauma you've been going through mentally and physically and spiritually, emotionally. You've been in that storm as Peter, as the disciples in that storm. But God says, I got you. He says, you are mine. I got you. The whole time they were in that storm, guess whose eyes were watching them? Jesus. He was standing there the whole time watching from the beginning to the end, watching. It was just a test. I'm here to tell you this morning what you're going through is just a test. It's just a test. Bow your head and close your eyes. Bow your head and close your eyes. Every person, not looking up at me. Father God, thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you for your living, breathing word. Lord, I thank you that your word shall not return void, but it shall prosper in that for which you sent it to do. It shall accomplish all you have called it to accomplish, Lord, that it will not return void. Jesus, you said John 6:63, that the words that you speak are life and peace. I thank you, Lord, that your word has been distributed this morning. Your word has been distributed this morning, Father, to the body this morning. So I thank you, Lord, that word that I have spoken this morning, that we have spoken, that word would enter their hearts. And as the word enters their hearts, I pray that they will be filled with the knowledge of your will, in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. I pray that they will walk worthy of you, fully pleasing unto you, being fruitful unto every good work. I pray that they will increase in the knowledge of you. I pray that they will be strengthened and reinforced with all might through your glorious power, the power that you exercised in Christ when you raised him from the dead. Now, Father God, I also ask that you would open the eyes of their understanding, that they will know. I pray that you would open the eyes of their understanding, Lord God, that they would be filled with the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, I believe this morning there are some people sitting out here this morning, and you don't, sir, ma'am, young man, you don't have a relationship with Jesus. Maybe you've come to church before. Maybe you've come to church in the past, and maybe you just accidentally stepped in here. Maybe you came with a friend this morning. Well, at the age of 22, I commit my life to Christ. My life has never been the same. The day I commit my life to Christ, I would have never thought. I've been in ministry now for close to 20 years. I would have never thought that I would be standing on platforms around the world. Up until I was 22, I was going through the greatest storm of my life. But here I am today, standing on the other side. What God has done for me, sir, what God has done for me, ma'am, He wants to do, and He's willing to do for each and every one of you. If you'll commit your ways to Him, He will order your steps. So if you're sitting out there this morning, this is a very serious moment. Very serious. Very, very serious. More serious than the feast that we were doing. So if you're sitting out there this morning, you know within your heart that, hey, I don't have a relationship with Jesus, but I want that relationship. I want to know that I'm saved. I want to know that I'm born again. But most importantly, while I'm here on this earth, I want to know that I'm fulfilling my purpose. You see, without a relationship with Jesus, sir, you will never, ever know your purpose on this earth. And you will live a life of existence, just merely existing, not living a life of substance that is found in the Holy Spirit. So if you're sitting out there this morning, you would say, hey, I want to commit my life to Christ. I want to do what you did, Ray. I see the effect that God has had on you in your life, in your marriage, in your relationships. I want that to happen in my life. So if that's you this morning, I want you to raise your hand high where I can see you. I want you to raise your hand high this morning. If you say, hey, I want to be born again. I want to be saved. I want to know that my sins are forgiven this morning. I want to spend eternity in heaven. You see, there's two destinations once our spirits exit our shells, our body. There are two destinations, sir. Two destinations, ma'am. One destination is heaven. For those of you who commit their lives to Christ, who live according to God's principles and concepts in His Word, those who live submitted to the will of God, the plan of God, the purpose of God, who have been born again, heaven is for you. But there is another place. It is a place called hell, which the Bible, Jesus talked about hell in the Bible. He talked about hell. Hell is very real, just as real as heaven. But the good news is this. Hell was never designed or created or fashioned for anyone in this room. It was actually, the Bible says, it was actually created for Lucifer and his fallen angels. But when you choose to act out of rebellion, sir, young man, when you choose to act out of rebellion, when you choose to be hard-hearted and stubborn and prideful and say, hey, I don't need that religious stuff in my life. You know what you're saying? You're saying, you're literally saying, hey, Jesus, I turn my back on your sacrifice on the cross, and I'll choose my own path. Well, that path is called the road to perdition. That means destruction. That path ends right in the place called hell. Hell is forever. It's for eternity. You don't have to go there, sir. You don't have to go there, ma'am. Young man, young lady. The Holy Spirit is reaching out to you today. He's reaching out to you today. He's saying, come, my son. He says, I want a relationship with you. There are things I want to share with you that you know not of. But I can't share those things with you unless I have a relationship with you. So today, if you'd like to commit your life to Jesus, know that you're born again. You want a fresh touch of God upon your life. I want you to raise your hand where I can see your hand. Raise it high. Raise those hands high. Raise those hands high. I see those hands. Now, with those hands raised, I want you to come very, very quickly because my time is far spent. It must come to a close. With your hands raised, I want you to come stand right there, right down here. Remember what Peter did. Peter stepped away from the crowd. You see, young man, if you keep following the crowd, you're going to end up where the crowd is going to end up. That's called the road to perdition, the road to destruction. Maybe you're trying to blend in. You're trying to be cool. You're trying to be hip. But you know what? That is the road to destruction. That is the road to destruction. The Word of God says, call unto me. He says, call unto me. He says, I will show you great and marvelous things, things that you know not of, things that are fenced in and hidden just for you. So if that is you, your hand's been raised, I want you to come. Stand right down here in front. Heaven is real. Hell is real. So if you've never been born again, if you've never been saved, I want you to come walk right down here. Stand right down here. See, the Bible says one day we must all, this is very close, this is very important. The Bible specifically says that one day we, meaning all of us, we will stand before Jesus Christ, the King of all glory, and we must give an account for the things that we have done in our bodies. And we will be judged on those things. Sir, when you stand before Jesus on that day, your wife won't be next to you. Your kids won't be next to you. It will be you and King Jesus, the judge. And what will he say to you on that day? As all the heaven has been removed, all of earth is removed, you're standing before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What will he say to you on that day in that moment? Will he say this? Because you called on his name, you believed on his name, you lived according to his principles. Will he say this? Good job, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. That's a great time. That's a momentous occasion. Great joy, great excitement, great happiness, great celebration. Or will you be part of the many? According to Matthew chapter 7, he says, many will say to me in that day. Listen, this is very important. It's not a time to be picking up your things trying to leave. I'm closing. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, didn't we perform signs? Didn't we perform miracles and prophesy in your name? But guess what he says to them, because there was never no relationship. He says, depart from me. I never knew you, you worker of iniquity, which means you worker of lawlessness, which means you lived according to the way you wanted to live. That's called lawlessness. That's called rebellion. Now, again, and I'm closing by saying that I'm not going to beg you or pump you or prime you. Only the Holy Spirit can draw you. I'm just giving you the correct information so you'll have understanding and context. Now, again, if you're sitting out there, and if you have never committed your life to Christ, the heat is on, baby, the heat is on. If you've never committed your life to Christ, but you would like to, I'm closing it right here, right now. I want you to jump up out your seat. The devil's trying to hold you down. He's whispering, say, oh, you know, you don't have to do it. Do it tomorrow. Tomorrow. This is what the devil tells people. Tomorrow. 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 You can get it right tomorrow. Meanwhile, there are many thousands of souls in hell. Meanwhile, there are thousands of souls in hell today. And the demons and devils, guess what? They're whispering to them. As they scream out of pain and torment, guess what they're saying? As they're screaming, they're saying, when can we get out of here? When can we get it out of here? Guess what the demons are saying to them in hell? Tomorrow. 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 Again, I close. Anyone else? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, guys. Hope you all see each other out tonight. Make sure you invite somebody. Bring somebody. Excuse me, let me correct myself. Let me review. Don't invite somebody, bring somebody. How about that? That sounds better, right? Don't invite somebody, bring somebody back this evening. You're going to be blessed. They will be blessed. You're going to see God move in your life and their lives as well. Thank you all so much. Thank you, Pastor John. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank you so much for being with us. Come back tonight. We're going to have another wonderful, wonderful service. Bring others with you, as you have just heard. And please, if you do need prayer, stay. Come up to the front here and be ministered onto. Thanks for being with us. God richly bless you. Amen.
And also, as Pastor John, if you need prayer, my wife would love to pray with you, believe in God for something in your life. We'll be standing down here, and we'd love to pray with you very quickly, all right? Thank you. God bless you all. Hope to see you all this evening. Be blessed. Favor of the Lord surround you like a shield. His ministering angels of power go with you. Amen.